You're a third-rate duelist with a fourth-rate deck.
Hello everyone and welcome back to my channel. Another case cap is here and once again I will make a list with free-to-play decks trying to help fellow free-to-play players out there on what they can build or just use for this case cap. Last time my decks were all free-to-play. Maybe not all super free-to-play friendly, because some needed time grinding to gather gems in order to build, and a ton of people seem to not get that, judging by their comments. Don't forget, not all free-to-play decks you can build straight off the bat after just watching a video. Most of my decks aim at showcasing decks you can build without spending real money, but also are competitive, not just cheap to build. And of course, if both criteria are met, that's awesome and all, but it's not always the case, unfortunately. That's why in this video, I will be talking about the best 5 cheap free-to-play decks you can play in this case cap. So no Dark Magician, Cyber Dragons, or even Crystrons on the list. Extremely important to note, most of the decks I will be showcasing today won't be able to carry you far in the second stage of the case cap, especially if you do not have staple spell and trap cards to use, since majority of them are not meta or exceptionally good against the current meta decks. But all of them have one thing in common, they can find success on the first stage, ranked, and of course some success on the second stage. So leave a like, also subscribe to the channel for more videos like this, and now let's get to my list. Number 5. Vendreds. I will start off with the oldest deck from the ones on the list. Although one variation of it, and the one I would actually recommend the most, is a hybrid with a newer archetype. But Vendreds were released in the Curse of Dread minibox, and they are a zombie ritual based deck. Their unique nature comes from the fact that some of their main monsters can banish opponent cards, a really strong effect of course. They have two ritual spells, Evolution and Origin, and combined these two can ritual summon from the hand or graveyard and allow the tributes to be from almost anywhere, even the deck. Slayer is their best ritual tool with a great multi-layered effect that helps their power but also consistency. Another consistency boosting card is Vendred Knights, and since the main monster Slayer can be considered a bit weak in the current meta, we also see Executor and Battlelord be useful beatsticks. As I said at the start, I would recommend you to play Vendreds as a hybrid, with none other than the Siranui archetype. They are also zombie monsters and can work in great synergy with Vendreds to create a ritual and synchro hybrid. Of course, that is not needed, you can run Vendreds by themselves, but sometimes that extra Siranui spark can help out a lot or catch the opponent off guard. The drawbacks of the deck are of course that it can be bricky, since at the end of the day it is a ritual strategy, and also it can be overwhelmed by the fast special summoning in the current metagame. Master of Rites 2 or level duplication are totally the skills to help you, or maybe level augmentation if you decide to run the hybrid with Siranui. Number 4. Super Heavy Samurai. A full monster deck that solely comes from the main box, Future Horizon. The bad thing for its affordability is not really the fact that Future Horizon is a main box, but more so the fact that it needs an ultra rare monster from that box, Super Heavy Samurai Wagon, which is preferred at either 1 or 2 copies, in most decks. The deck has a synchro strategy and can use its synchro monsters to attack while in defense position, by actually using their defense stat as their attack stat, something you don't encounter every day. The reason they don't run any spell or trap cards is because they go against their monsters' special summoning conditions, and also some of their monsters have graveyard effects with enough utility for you to be in a relatively okay position without running main staples in your deck. Super Heavy Samurai Giga Gloves makes your opponent's monster's attack stat non-existent, and Flutist protects your Super Heavy Samurai monsters from targeting effects. The deck can struggle finding momentum sometimes and also drawing power, but really important is also the fact that you can be OTK'd easily if you don't get your combos going immediately. That's exactly the reason why Grit is the skill preferred even after its nerf. You can also experiment with other skills in the game, like Destiny Draw if you think it's better for your specific decklist. Number 3. Ritual Beasts. A heavy combo and special summoning oriented deck that has some difficult plays, which of course can be extremely rewarding when you actually master them. They arrived in the Spirit of the Beast minibox, and they do have highly rarity cards, ultra rare and super rare, as a core 3 of in their ratios, but at least the whole archetype comes from that one mini box only. Ritual Beasts might sound like a ritual deck, but they are actually a fusion deck, and they get divided into two subcategories: the Ritual Beast Tamers and the Spiritual Beasts. Tamers on the field together can be contact fusioned into a fusion monster, which most of the time in the build-up will be Ritual Beast Ulti Kanahok in order for the searching to begin. Then the fusion monsters can unfuse into two new monsters, an ability that actually allows them to play around some stuff the meta throws at them, like specific back row. Of course, they also have limitations to their special summoning, so it cannot go on forever in one turn. In addition to that, they are the only deck so far that have been included in a ban list with Ritual Beast Tamer Elder. Their other core tamer, Winda, is still allowed at 3 and super important for the flow of the deck. Ritual Beast Ulti Apelio and Spiritual Beast Kanahok are two more core pieces you absolutely need to run 3 of. I would also strongly advise you to run Cosmic Cyclone and Sphere Kuribo or Floodgate with this deck to help you with some utility Ritual Beasts actually lack. Another first for the list, because the other decks so far did not really need staples. Their skills of choice would probably be Destiny Draw, Switcheroo, or even Sealed Tombs if Shiranui prove a real problem to go against in the KC Cup. Number 2, Shiranui. I bet some of you thought they would be number 1. But the reason they are not is because I cannot guarantee the safety of your investment in Shiranui, since they are a high usage and a great deck that maybe will get another addition to the ban list after this KC Cup. The deck originated from the Soul of Resurrection minibox, but also got new support in the newest minibox, Flames of the Heart. I have talked extensively about Shiranui, so you can also check some of my other content on them. But I want to stress that they are an explosive synchro deck with a control playstyle. They can't run Cosmic Cyclone or Enemy Controller anymore, since now Shiranui Squire is limited to 3 and Shiranui Spectral Sword, their main tuner, limited to 2. Although, have in mind if you are new to the game, in order for Shiranui to work to their full potential, they need good staple back row cards like Floodgate, Paleozoic Canadia, or the more new Fiendish Chain from the selection box, and even Ballista Squad. They also cannot use Gold Sarcophagus anymore, but they have new toys in the name of Ghost Meets Girl that just came out. A great quick play spell that gives them more plays and potential. Make no mistake, the deck can work without the new cards, but I think Ghost Meets Girl will be a helpful addition to the deck. Of course, the support is really new, so more information on their performance will be gathered during the KC Cup. As I already mentioned, they can run a hybrid with Vendredge, but also the newly released Mayakasi. Something I would not really advise a free-to-play player to go after though. In my opinion, the deck can be played at its best with level augmentation right now, so totally test your builds with that skill. And of course, here are some example decklists. And at the number one spot, Aromazes. Here they are, the most easy deck to build in the entirety of Yu-Gi-Oh! Duelings. A deck that everyone wanted me to add last time, but their box was extremely new and we had no intel on it, alongside with the fact that I did not think they can do really good in the second stage. I actually still do think that. Aromazes are a really cheap deck built from tickets, the card trader, and the minibox Fortress of Gears, since the only box super rare they need is Humid Winds. Probably some synchro monsters too though. But the thing is, their strategy is straightforward and they are not a meta deck strong enough to carry you far in the second stage of this or any KC Cup without more support. Of course, that is not a bad thing for everyone, since not every player aims for top 10s or top 100s or even top 500 regional spots. Aromazes are a plant deck, based around gaining life points and trying to control different situations. Humid Winds is absolutely a core card now that it's released, since it allows you to spend all those life points you gain in order to search Aromaz monsters, giving the deck a really needed searcher. You don't even need the card at 3, one or two copies is fine I think. Aromaz Kananga is another important card for the deck because it gives you the ability to return a back row card back to your opponent's hand. Aroma Gardening is another core card that will help you special summon a lot from your deck. My main concerns with Aromazes are that they have a ceiling as a deck and can find it really hard to deal with fast-paced meta decks. Another drawback is that the deck may depend a lot on random synchro monsters at times, like Black Rose Dragon or even Dragon of the Ice Barrier if you use those. I have to admit though, the deck is extremely cheap to build, super free-to-play friendly, and easy for a newer player to learn duelings with. I think balance should be the skill you choose to run them with in order to improve consistency as much as you can by running 6 of each type of card. Monsters, spells, and traps of course. And that's my list. I hope I helped you find the cheapest free-to-play deck best suited for you and your playstyle to run in the KC Cup. For two more expensive but also better and more future-proof free-to-play decks, you can check out the video I did for the last KC Cup with Dark Magician and Cyber Dragon on the list. Link for that will also be in the description. Leave a like if you enjoyed and also subscribe for more free-to-play decks and content. Thank you so much for watching, stay safe, best of luck in the KC Cup, and I'll see you in the next one.